It's another exciting edition. Madison Park Academy Athletic Department Podcast. I got a young man that I'm interviewing today. He's got a lot of greatness about him. And I've known him a long time. I've been around this young man since my early days at Madison Park before I was the athletic director. And it's wonderful to have this time to interview him on this podcast, Habeeb Tiamiyu. What's going on, Habeeb?
Good, Coach.
Hey, man, did I say that last name right?
It's Tiamiyu, but you're pretty close.
I'm close. You know, I've been working on it for years, right?
Yeah.
At least I know how to spell it. I remember when I couldn't even spell it.
Right.
Habeeb T. I don't know. I don't know how to say it, but you know me. I'm big on knowing people's names, how to say it right, and how to spell it right. I think that's big. If I'm going to represent you to colleges and let colleges know about you, I mean, the last thing I want as a recruiter to think that I don't really know you because I don't even know how to spell your name. I don't even know how to pronounce it. So I said Tiamiyu. 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 Oh, that's the difference. Tiamiyu. Got it. So I had that little pronunciation in the middle. I had that wrong. Now I got it right. That's what's up. So what's been going on today, man? You doing all right? You ready for this interview?
For sure. You know, when you told me last week, I was like, I knew it was coming too. I knew it was.
Oh yeah. You one of my guys. So you knew it couldn't be too far out the line. You know, once Sir Khalil did it, you pretty much knew. Well, you know, I'm pretty probably close up there where he gonna pick me. Check out my picture in the background, man. Look at you.
I think that's the one we broke the 4x1 record too.
Yeah. Yeah, and here's the thing. You guys broke the 4x1 record this year, and you guys did safe handoffs. I can tell those are safe handoffs. In a real 4x1, you would never be looking back towards KJ. So the mere fact that you guys broke the school record and you're doing safe handoffs, imagine what would have happened if we were able to have the rest of those 10 meets. That would have been pretty nice.
Uh-huh.
So let's get into it, man. I'm looking forward to this again. Habeeb, I say Tiamiyu, but I got to work on. Oh, I'm going to do it right now. So it's Tiamiyu. Uh-huh. Did you get it right?
Yeah.
Tiamiyu.
Tiamiyu.
Miyu. That's it. Tiamiyu. Tiamiyu. So the I is like the I sound in machine. So it's kind of like it's got a old Koine Greek inflection to it. Tiamiyu.
Uh-huh.
Oh, I got it now. See, all I had to do was kind of look at it from a Greek perspective. Now I got it. Wonderful. Tell me a little bit about your family. Tell me about your siblings.
I got two other siblings. I got a brother and a sister. We're from Nigeria. My brother and my sister, they both in college, UC Berkeley. So that's where I get, you know, I have a reputation to live up to. So.
Oh, yes, sir. Yes, sir. Now, I know your brother. He was one of the pioneer players for the soccer team at Madison Park, wasn't he?
Mm-hmm.
Now, your sister, did she go to Madison Park?
No, she did.
Okay, that's why I don't know her. I'm like, a sister? I'm not familiar with a sister. I know you had an older brother. When you said sister, I thought you might have meant somebody younger. But they're both at UC Berkeley.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, man, you can't fart around, man. Maybe that's why you've always been serious about grades, though. And I love that family pressure of keeping those grades up. Because your brother, like yourself, is kind of a quiet leader. And I learned a lot about him in his senior year. And it's phenomenal to have you as his brother. You play different sports than he played. Neither one of you played the same sports. So we'll get a little bit more into it. How are your parents doing?
She's doing good, you know, with the whole coronavirus thing, you know, they've been here and there, but it's pretty cool though.
All right. When did you first start playing sports?
I grew up playing sports. I never played basketball or ran track before. I used to play soccer like my brother. But
really? That's funny. I never known you to play. You know, if Coach Garibay Garibay, you know what's going to happen when Coach Garibay hears this interview, right? And Coach Weiss, you know what's going to happen when they hear this interview.
Coach Weiss actually knew I played soccer. He told me to join, but I was like, I got basketball.
I had to figure out a way. So you grew up playing soccer. When did you start playing basketball?
I started playing basketball seventh grade for Madison. That's when I first really started playing. So
I was there when you was playing. I think I was coaching you guys during that time, the middle school. Trying to hold it down. No. There was another guy there who was a part of the after school program, and then I took it over later because I was like, look, they need to take this to the next level. Mm-hmm. Yeah, something like that. Well, why did you start picking up? What influenced you to kind of, because you've kind of abandoned soccer. I don't know you at all as a soccer player. Never.
Yes.
Again?
You said what?
When was the last time you played soccer?
Sixth grade for the team, because I went to Alliance in sixth grade. So I played soccer for the team. But when I got to Madison, I wanted to play a new sport, and then I played basketball.
So what influenced you to play basketball?
Because when the soccer season ended for the Lions, I had one of my friends, and when we be in the gym, he told me to come play with him. And he showed me new moves and stuff like that. And ever since then, I liked it. I started playing more and more. I be going to basketball hoops, started shooting. And since then, you said you was pulling the flyer out that you wanted to start basketball for middle school. So I just signed up, and here we are now.
Man, I mean, you're a sophomore in high school.
Yeah.
And I go back to like it had to be at least your seventh grade year at Madison when you was just little, small, scrawny kid. Now you're about as tall as I am now. Your voice has gotten deeper since COVID-19 hit. Habeeb's a little man. I love it. I love seeing, as an athletic director, man, I really love the longevity of my time there, because I really get to see y'all go from this like real boyish childhood to becoming like real young men. And you're like one of the best of the best, man. If I'm talking about an all-time top five of Madison Park young men, I mean, you definitely in the top five straight up. So this is amazing for me to be able to do this interview, because I know I'm going to learn some things about you that I don't know, but I'm looking forward to it. So who's the most inspirational athlete in your life all times? If all other athletes had to be locked away in prison, which one athlete would you keep free?
And we're talking about any, right?
Any athlete, all time. Most influential.
Gotta be Steph Curry.
Why do you say that?
Because I remember when I started playing basketball, that's the only video I'd be searching up. I searched a Steph Curry highlight, mixtape, all that. I watch it, study his game. Everybody trying to shoot threes now, all that. So I watched Steph Curry, and I could say he's one of the people that inspired me to play basketball too. So,
do you remember in your seventh grade year when you guys would be in the gym with me practicing basketball? Do you remember my rule, my number one rule?
Oh, three.
Would you like to elaborate for the people why I made that rule, no threes in the gym? I don't even care if we're just doing pickup stuff. No, don't. If you shoot a three in the gym, what happened to you?
You tell us, you give us a one at first, and if we keep doing it, you send us out. You're closing it up.
Now tell the people why we had to do that.
You had to do that because you told us to take smart shots, because we don't really take that in the game. So you're telling us practice. When we practice how we play in the game. So you said no threes.
Exactly. Unless you're a three-point shooter, you ain't shooting threes in practice. If we ain't expecting you to shoot a three in a game, don't be shooting threes in practice. But Steph Curry, the influence of Steph Curry, man. He's got guys doing – he's got NBA players doing stuff they've never done before. LeBron James didn't shoot three-pointers the way he shoots three-pointers now. You know, Harden didn't shoot three-pointers. Westbrook, he didn't shoot three. Nobody shot three-pointers the way Steph Curry started shooting three-pointers, man. It's been wild. It's been wild. Now, you know, I got a bone to pick. Football. In middle school, I watched you on the flag football team, I think, for one season. And you had, in my opinion, you could easily develop into a D1 wide receiver. We're looking at it on the eye test, your height, your hands, your speed, your ability to run routes. And for at least one season, you did at least flag football at the middle school level. And I was hoping to see you go to tackle football at the high school level. Why didn't you play football? What is it about football that just wouldn't hold your attention?
I say, well, first of all, when the team was formed, I think we only had like the season. We was trying to have a season last year, but it got canceled, didn't it?
Yeah, it's because we didn't have enough players dedicated to the sport, and I wasn't going to allow Madison Park to disrespect football. Couldn't do that.
The main reason why I really don't play football no more is because I lost interest, I guess, since when I started playing basketball. I guess the interest for football kind of went away. But
So then you just
really, that's what it is.
Basketball.
Yeah, really...
I get it. You know, I'm a football coach. I coached y'all in basketball because we needed a coach until I could find a coach, and I found Coach Ken. And then now we have Coach Phil, who's on the line of Coach Ken. So he's like, I guess Coach Phil is my grandson in basketball. I don't think he's gonna like me saying that. Good brother though. All right. Tell me about your track and field career. Last season, right before coronavirus hit, you were in your first season of track and field as a freshman in high school. Tell me a little bit about what your thoughts were about track and field. You only got a third of a season in. But what was that third of a season like for you?
If I have to say something about track and field, it's for sure that it's different than any other sport. Because before I even ran, you told me this. You said you're not racing with other people. You're racing against time. And after I figured that out, the first meet we went to, it was early in the morning. It was like 7. You told us we had to get there to school by 7. I was like, we got to wake up that early. When we got into the bus and stuff, when we got there, I saw other people running and stuff. So I was ready too. And then we got on the line. At first, I didn't really know how to use the block that good, but I adjusted to it. But I say track and field is really fun though.
You know, this meet where this picture in the background is where you really took a whole different leap in your track and field. And I mean, you were in this on this relay. You were on that relay with Anthony Coleman, correct?
Yeah.
So he's a track and field legend. First student at Madison Park to ever make it to the state meet. And he made it to state meet in an event that we don't even have at the campus for him to practice at. So it's phenomenal. That's a whole different story. But in this meet here, after this meet, I think your name went into the record books at least 3 or 4 times for breaking relay records. How did that, did you know that you were going to break a record that day? And if not, you didn't know you were going to break a record. So how did you feel by the time you got back to school on Monday and the new track and field records were updated and you see your name on there several times as a freshman having broke relay records at Madison Park Academy?
When I first saw it, I was surprised because I feel like in that race, we could have even ran better. So we already breaking it at that. And then when I thought about it, I was eager to break a new record. Emmanuel York, if you're watching this, I'm coming for that 400 time too.
Ah, tell him about it. Although I don't think Emmanuel has the 400 record. That's Anthony.
Nah, he doesn't have it. But when I ran my 400, I think he's the next person on the list that I could beat.
I see what you say. So you look down the list and you said, okay, here's my time. Right above me is Emmanuel York. So you send a notice to Emmanuel York that you about to take his record. You about to drop him down the list. You about to go ahead of him. Oh, I love it. I love it. You know, it's funny that you bring up Emmanuel because I've always, you know, it's not good to compare people, but I think when you're comparing somebody with somebody who's great, I think the comparison is in order. In basketball, I've always said you are Emmanuel York's replacement. Now, understand, Emmanuel York is a two-time MVP.
Yes, he is.
CIF, Oakland section. He's the SPAC player of the year, male athlete of the year, and received a scholarship in the thousands to attend San Jose State University. So when I liken you to him, that's high praise. That young man has a banner hanging in our building at Madison Park because he's a two-time MVP. How do you – now, I understand track and field. You're going to knock him off the porch. What about that basketball, though?
Basketball, I don't know if you remember this, but you assigned him as my sports mentor in, I think, 7 or 8. And he was my coach. Him and Anthony was my coach for 8th grade basketball.
Right.
So, and here and there, we have been pick up basketball. And I've been learning a lot from him. Because now that I'm all, like, I got taller and stuff, he'd be teaching me, like, new moves. Like, instead of doing all that dribble move, just one step and go. So, I've really been learning a lot from him. So, I'm trying to pass him up in that, too.
And you know what I like about that? Is that when you surpass him, it will be because he thought it not robbery to help mentor you. That's really what it's all about. And guess what? When we get back from coronavirus and we find out who these new 6th graders are or what 7th graders are new, you're going to get one of them. And guess what? They're going to be 4 or 5 years from now talking about Habeeb. That's what's dope about it. I love it. I love it. So, what are your basketball goals this season? I'm sure we're going to get to basketball sometime in March. Basketball season will go from March to about June. What are your hopes for basketball? What are your personal goals this year?
My personal goal since the old seniors have left, my goal is really take a spot in the starting team, like solidify, because Kendall already left, Anthony left. We need a new replacement, and I feel like me, I have to play to my full potential for us to get the team, because we have to get the team back to the same way it was before. So,
right, you're in the sophomore, so you got 3 years to really shine. Although you were brought up to the varsity team, were you not, as a freshman?
Yeah, I was.
Yeah, that's good. That's a big deal, because Coach Phil wasn't interested in having a 15-man roster. He said, "I only want 8," and for you to be a part of that, that's a big deal. I look forward for your development too. What about track and field? You have any
track and field? Yeah, we didn't really get to do that much last season, but like I said before, I'm trying to beat Emmanuel in the 400. I'm trying to really get faster, get more comfortable when I'm running, fix my form and stuff like that. So I'm looking forward to that too.
All right. Well, we look forward to training you in the 400. That's my area of specialties. Coach Rome Peterson, our head coach of boys track and field, does a phenomenal job with all of our sprinters. But when it comes to the 400, that's where I step in. And so I look forward to teaching you the strategies and overseeing that as he continues to develop you as a sprinter, because all of that then translate to you on the basketball court. You know, at Madison Park, we said, hey, you came for a basketball game, but really what you came to see was a track meet with a basketball. So I like how we approach that. Let's switch reels a little bit. How has virtual learning changed your educational approach? How has it changed your education?
A lot of people really complain about it, but I don't see it as being too difficult for me, because a day we have 2 classes, and that's really easy. But I see where people come in and say it's kind of difficult because it's harder to grasp what the teacher's trying to teach you online. But it hasn't really affected me that much. It really been easy. I could get the work done. Teacher, they be having help. Like, they be having help, so they just make an extra Zoom link and just joined it at a certain time. So it really hasn't really changed that much for me, but I would love to go back in person, though.
You'd like to go back in person? So let me ask you this question. What do you believe, if you had the power, what would the future of public school look like, considering what we're going through right now in this pandemic, finding out that public school is not prepared for a pandemic? Now we got this thing called Zoom school. You got Google Meets. You got basically distance learning. If you were in charge of public education, how would you go about creating public education for students?
What you mean? As in, should we go back to school or keep doing this?
Yeah, like, is it all online? Is it coming back to school? Is it, you know, some people at school, some people not at school? Is it certain days you're at? I mean, how would you do? How would you cut it up? If you could
be honest,
find a way, how would you do it?
To be honest, I say probably a group of people going to school, but it's going to be like a rotation to it. It's not everybody just at school one time, because we still got to keep the distance. And everybody have different classes, so we could have like a few people in one class, a few people in other classes, and then the next day they don't have to go, a whole new rotation of students go. So that's how I would do it.
I see. I feel that. So like some kids would have a Monday, Wednesday schedule. Mm-hmm. Some kids would have a Thursday, Tuesday, Thursday mm-hmm. schedule. And maybe Friday is that day where, you know, kids who need extra work, where teachers are kind of all tutors on that day. I can see that. All right. What do you believe? Now, you're one of the few students who has been in athletic department middle school, and you know the athletic department high school. What are the difference, if any?
Difference is when you get to high school, there's more expectation. You can't just be doing the same thing you were doing in middle school. That goes for academics too. Sport, because now when you get to, when you're in middle school, you could be on a team. You don't even have to be really, really trying. You just be on the team. But when it's high school, it's different. You have to contribute to the team if you want to stay on the team. So that's really different. You got to be more focused. You got to be more hardworking if you really want to perform at the high school level.
Yeah, I agree with you. And we do that on purpose. You know, we try to groom you, you know, having fun, grooming you at the middle school level, developing you. But when we get to high school, it's all about accountability, responsibility, knowing your role and fulfilling the role for the team, for the betterment of the school. You're not your last name. You're a Trojan who just happens to have a different last name. But in the end, you are a Trojan. All right. What sport, name a sport you have never played, but would at least like to try once?
Probably baseball. I'll try baseball.
Baseball?
I also try golf. It looks fun. It looks fun, but I would try that too.
You know they have high school golf teams, right?
They do?
Yeah, they have high school golf teams.
I would try that out.
But they play during basketball and track and field.
Oh, it's always that time.
I think they do. I can find out for you. You know, can you imagine Madison Park having a boys golf team? That probably
That would be fun. That would be fun.
Guys in your khakis and polo shirts, your mm-hmm. golf shoes. Okay. What are the characteristics? And I ask you this question because I have always seen you as a leader, never as a follower. I think if I've ever got on you, it's because you might have been doing some possible follower stuff, because that ain't you. Having said, what do you believe are the top three characteristics of a good leader?
A good leader? For sure, communication. Mm-hmm. I'm going to say responsibility. And I'm gonna say either tolerance or like the ability to like make everybody work together. I'm gonna say teamwork. Because if you want to lead, you have to be able to understand your other teammates. You have to understand what's going on and how to lead. You just can't want to take the role and just be acting any type of way. You have to really. You have to really show, and you have to like demand respect too, because nobody's just gonna follow just anybody. You have to make it shown like you want to lead. You really mean it.
So to be a good leader, you gotta want to lead. You gotta want to demand the respect that comes with leading. But would you say also you gotta also display the respect of leading?
You also got to, because if people gonna follow you, they're gonna follow you. If they want to follow what you're doing, you have to be doing something that's actually worth following.
I like that. If you want people to follow you, you got to be doing something worth following. Yeah, and all following ain't equal. So, yeah, I like that. Good perspective. What's your favorite academic class?
Academic class? Either currently right now, I'm going to have to say either math or chemistry.
Math because
although sometimes it'd be hard, but when you really get it, like the excitement you get from like solving a question is different than any other subject. And I'm going to say chemistry because I like the topics we're talking about, especially forensic science. We're talking about fingerprinting and stuff like that. So it's really interesting.
Did I take chemistry? No, I think I took an aggressive form of biology. I took science, but when I look back, and with all the episodes during COVID-19 of Forensic Files that I've watched, I think I'd have been a pretty good detective if I could learn forensic. A real sleuth. That's funny. What is your favorite flavor of ice cream?
Chocolate. Yeah, it's basic or whatever, but it's just chocolate. Don't do too much.
Okay. I got a funny question for you. How did you learn how to ride a bike?
Oh. All right. I remember this was elementary. I bought a new bike. I was excited. I was outside in front of my house. I was trying to get on it, trying to ride it. It was really difficult. No, I started on a three-wheeler. Really. When I got to a two-wheeler, this was difficult. I scraped my knee many times. Still got the marks on my leg, but it was difficult. But my brother was with me trying to learn it, so it was like the experience was fun and stuff. But after I got it, after I started by riding a few steps, I was like, oh, I could do this. I got it.
So what is it like having an older brother to kind of mentor you along the way and something? I mean, you have your dad, but you also have an older brother. So you kind of got like two positive male role models in your life. What's that like? Because there's a lot of young men who don't have one.
Having the older brother, I feel like it makes things more easier because he's done the thing I'm doing. So when I'm seeing him doing the stuff, like we were talking about leader, I'll be trying to do it too. And it'd be really good for me. So he'd be teaching me stuff I didn't know before and stuff like that.
Yeah, your brother was a high GPA kid too. And he got into UC Berkeley on academics, not athletics. So I just want to make sure people, even though he was a stellar, an awesome, amazing soccer player, he got into UC Berkeley strictly on the strength of his grades. And so you're going to have the opportunity to do both. So I'm looking forward to that. What female and male student athlete at MPA do you most appreciate? Appreciate like you want to go watch, like if you had only a couple of bucks to pay to go see them play, this is the person you're gonna go pay to see play if you had to. Let's go female first.
Female, I'm gonna have to say London Edwards, because she's in my grade and I've seen her break so many track records for when she was running the 100-meter, 200, and I'm pretty sure she was close to breaking the 400 too. So yeah,
she missed the 400 by 6/100ths of a second. Yeah.
So I would say her for female, and for male, I'm gonna have to go either Anthony Coleman or Emmanuel York. Still got one of them too.
Those today alumni now. That's good stuff. So you got Emmanuel. I'll write this down, and Anthony Coleman. Good stuff. Good. And they were your coaches in the eighth grade when I had student. I started the student athlete coaches for middle school during that year when you was in the eighth grade. That's what's up. All right. So now I remember this. This is a question that I was in a meeting earlier today and I was so excited. I was asked about, you know, hey, what do I got to do for the rest of the day? I said, well, look, after this meeting, I get to interview Habeeb. I'm really excited about this interview because I know a lot about him, but I know I'm going to learn a lot about him in this kind of interview because he's becoming a, you know, he's a young adult male. He's a little boy. Now he's a young adult male. And I'm just, you know, he's one of my favorite kids, you know, people. And it was Miss Marshall. She said, make sure you ask him a question about Ramadan. I said, oh, wow, yeah. Because I remember your brother in a playoff soccer match during Ramadan and what was going on during that time and how he overcome great adversity. How do you first explain to people who don't know what Ramadan is, what it is, and talk about a little bit about how things change for you during that season of life?
Ramadan is, it happens every year, once a month. It's when you have to fast. You wake up like around 3 o'clock, you eat, and then you can't eat till sunset, all the way to nighttime. What it's really about is you getting closer to God. I'm Muslim, so it's really like a month just for like praising God and just appreciating and stuff like that. What was the other question?
So you just shared about how you get up early in the morning while it's still dark, yeah, and you eat before the sun's on the earth where you are, and then you cannot eat again.
Eat or drink
until it's totally dark again. So after sunset, right? But during Ramadan, there are times where you have to go to practice and or you have games. And you can't eat or drink anything before the game. If you get winded, you can't like have a squirt of water until it's dark. How do you go through that? Because there's a lot of students who go through it. But very few students have the opportunity to express what's going on. How do you do that? And how have your teammates, that's another good question, how have your teammates responded to that?
I'm going to have to say, for you to be able to do that, you have to have communication with your teammate and coach. You can't really perform as the ability as you was if you was fully, you know, if you have full food in your stomach and stuff like that. So it's really about communication. And it's all about mental, too. If you really want to get it done, you don't get it done. If you is hungry at the time, but you know, if you got to contribute for the team, you got to do what you got to do. But it's like the playing time is like, it decreases a little bit when you talk with your coach. So,
yeah, I remember when, we had some students, we had, you remember, Hamed, he played on the
floor. Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Observing Ramadan. And we would be like, we every year, cause he like played football for 3 years, and I remember because I was his position coach, I would have to know when he was on that, when he was celebrating, observing Ramadan. And I wanted to respect that. Although I'm Christian, he's Muslim, but I'm like, look, young man, if you're gonna do the things that are necessary to please God the way you understand it, then I'm gonna help facilitate your ability to do that. And I remember we would pull him out the game, like, are you all right? Are you cool? Like, nah, coach, I'm all right. I'm good. All right, let's get him back into the game. You know, and we didn't talk about food around him. We made sure that we didn't offer him water or try to, you know, we were just very, very responsible in our desire to support him as best as we could humanly possibly support him. Do you feel during that time you're supported? Have you ever felt like you weren't supported? And what could we as an athletic department do better to support you in these areas?
I'm not gonna lie, y'all do really good. Madison would do really good about that. Y'all have a good understanding of what it is and what people do. And y'all make sure y'all do everything y'all can to help support the person. So for running, it's pretty good for what I've seen.
Good stuff. Cool. I don't wanna take nothing for granted. And you're the only one that can tell me if we're doing good or bad. So I gotta ask the question because I love you enough to give me an honest answer. And so I appreciate that. And if in the future, because you still got 3 more years at Madison, if in the future you feel like that we can step it up in another level to kind of help the students that are like that, or maybe do a better job knowing what other students are observing, then make sure you pull us by the side, man, and say, hey, coach, we got some females on the tennis team who you don't even know they're Muslim. They never told you they were, but they're observing Ramadan. We got to make sure we support them too. So be very clear about that. What are your top three college choices? What top three colleges are you looking at to attend?
Currently, I haven't been really doing that much research yet, but UC, I'm thinking about getting into like one of the UC schools, maybe Berkeley, maybe one of them. I haven't really dived into that much. I've still been looking because I'm still trying to figure out what career choice I really, really want in the future. So I'm still deciding on that. And then I'm going to look for college the best for that. So,
well, you're a sophomore. Complete your sophomore year. And then as you're going into your junior year, you want to start at least having a top 10.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think it would have been easier if it was at school because there would have been more teachers to talk to, like really, really talk to face to face. But
okay. Well, you do also know that if you ever need help like that along the way, let me know, because definitely available to you for this type of help. You're going to have, if an athletic scholarship develops for you, I'm going to be a part of that process anyway. There's a lot of things you need to do in preparation for that too. But again, you know, we're not just looking at athletic scholarships. You have the capacity to get academic scholarships. So that opens the lid completely open for you. So we'll make that happen. All right. All right, I got a zany question. If you were a cartoon character, who would it be?
Avatar.
Avatar? Avatar. Mm-hmm. Explain.
Because he got the elements. Because me, if I want to be a cartoon character, I want to have powers. He has all the elements. I said, that's pretty cool. He could use whatever he wants. That's powerful. I like that.
All right. Super dope. If you had the opportunity to live the life of a celebrity for one day, what celebrity life would you choose?
A celebrity life. If I pick them, I could do whatever they're doing too, right?
Whatever they do, you get to do for one full day.
I'm probably going to say Steph Curry too. You know, his wife is a very good cook. I'm going to be eating really, really good for that day.
His wife,
Yeah. Hopefully, it's a game day too. Go in the crowds, shooting wild, crazy shots because I'm Curry. You know, it'll be a good day.
You're going to take the tunnel shot too?
Yep. Everything he do, the pre-workout, all that.
All of that. All right. Last few questions. Favorite color?
Blue. Simple.
Favorite candy?
Sour Patch.
Okay. Favorite sandwich?
Sandwich? I'm about to say a chicken sandwich. Chicken sandwich.
Fried or baked?
Fried.
Yeah, all right, who makes the best chicken sandwich?
Oh. fast food wise?
If only one restaurant, fast food or regular restaurant, could make chicken sandwiches, who would you give the right to keep on making chicken sandwiches?
I would say Chick-fil-A, but they're not close to me, so I'm gonna have to go with probably I'm going to have to go with Wendy's.
All right. What's your favorite app?
App? YouTube or Netflix.
YouTube or Netflix. All right. Uh-huh. And so YouTube or Netflix. So you watch Netflix.
Mm-hmm.
What's your favorite show on Netflix?
I can't tell you because it's too much. It's like you like something for a week and then it's like it changes again. I can't.
I feel that because I've been binge watching a particular show, and like the first two seasons, they was leaving you kind of ambiguous on some stuff. And then they got into season four, and I'm like, okay, come on, y'all. Why are these things being introduced?
Right.
Come on, now I've been loving the show. Now y'all trying to force some stuff. You kind of go to the extreme. Just keep the show where it was, because that was funny while I was watching. Now I'm fast forwarding stuff because I don't want to see all that. I'm sorry.
Right.
I'm sorry.
So when it comes to favorite movie or show, I can't.
Have you watched Bridgerton?
Nah, I don't think so.
I watched that. That was quite interesting. Fascinating on multitude of levels. I don't know if young people your age would like it.
What's it about?
It's about a guy who is like of royalty, and he doesn't want to get married because of, or have children because of how his father treated him as a child. His mother died while giving birth. And then he falls in love with this girl who's a, who's not of royalty, but she comes from a well-to-do family. And so it's kind of like this back and forth. She needs to find a husband. He doesn't want a wife. So they create this ruse to where they're dating so that other women won't be trying to push their daughter onto him, and other men who may want her will step up to try to marry her because, they need to try to get a shot at marrying her before she actually marries the Duke. But but the queen is a black woman. She's black. And it's a lot of interracial stuff. But what I like about, so it's a Shonda Rhimes piece. What I like about it is they're blurring the lines of history, something that other directors and producers have done regarding history in the past around black people. So, in the past, they've had movies like Cleopatra or, you know, Queen Nefertiti, and they have casted white actors and white actresses to play these roles that historically are people of African descent. So what Shonda Rhimes did was create this show that's kind of really blurring the lines. And it's, well, here's why you should watch it. Because it'll be the first show you watch where it appears racism never existed. That's what's kind of trippy about it. Everybody is free. Everybody is of the same. Either you're royal blood or you're not. Everybody's kind of like in the same social class, kind of. But nothing is like black versus white. Black's unworthy than white. It's really, in today's time, really weird to watch, but I think it's worthy of watching because it'll at least give you a view of what the world could be like without all the accents, you know.
Right. Think about it. Check that out.
All right, you guys, this is the Madison Park Academy Athletic Department. We didn't really mean to go on that old long Netflix binge, but that's my guy, Habeeb. Habeeb, give me your final comments, man.
Thank you for letting me be on the show, the podcast. I had a lot of fun doing this. It'll be cool to be here next time.
Well, we're definitely going to have you again, man. You're a sophomore doing big things. We appreciate you. We love you, man. You know that love is real, and we're going to always look out for your interest. All right, Madison Park. All right, world, make sure that you support us in all things Madison. It's all about the Trojans, baby. We'll talk to y'all later. Let me tell you about the feelings I've been for you when I try. I'll make some sort of attempt. I simp. Damn, I wish I wasn't such a wimp. Cause then I would let you know that I'm going if I was your man, then I would beat you. The only lying I would do is in the bed with you. But I'm trying to tell someone who loves you dearly. He has loved me tender. The latter.